ESPN 1420, ESPN1420.com. Let's welcome him on right now, as promised. Rage of Cajun All-American pitcher Gunnar Leje joins us on the airwaves. Gunnar, what's going on, man?
Nothing much. How are you?
I'm good. Appreciate you making the time, brother. Take us through the process, if you will. Tuesday night, team started contacting you, and was it just waiting for the right offer that never came? How did it go down?
The draft started on Monday, and so that's rounds one to or the top 75 picks.
Right.
And then Tuesday is rounds 3 to 10. And kind of, for the past 6 months, ever since the Cape Cod in the summer, we'd kind of been hearing rounds 4 to 6 was kind of when it was going to happen, when I would get picked. So that's kind of what we came into Tuesday expecting. So we started getting calls Tuesday morning, actually. A few teams called and kind of were talking more around 6 and 7. And so that's what we were expecting going into that. And then the calls really started picking up whenever the sixth round started. Teams started calling and kind of trying to fill out what kind of, where we stood as far as money and picks and all that. And then it really picked up in the seventh. And again, they were kind of asking the same questions. And then a team actually tried to kind of make a deal in the eighth, and put an offer on the table. I had a number money wise that I was comfortable with leaving and foregoing my senior year. And again, we were kind of expecting at least the top 10 rounds. And so the deals that were put on the table in round 7, 8, and 9 just weren't worth it to me. And so, here we stand. So
do you care to share the ballpark what that number was?
It was, honestly, I'd rather not. I'd rather
All right. No problem. No problem, man. So it's a fluent situation, right? There are a lot of teams calling, and how much do you sort of prepare yourself beforehand? Because this is sort of in a lot of ways, a life-changing decision, certainly for the next year. And you got to kind of think quick. I mean, I guess you kind of go into it with a baseball mentality?
Yeah. Again, I'd rather not share the number, but what I can say is that when you get into, especially in all the top 10 rounds, every pick has a determined slot value, so it has an allotted amount of money that they can give you. They can't go over that, but it counts against them as far as it goes to their pool of money in total. So they have a X amount of dollars that they can spend, right, in the top 10 rounds. And so when we got into rounds 7, 6, 7, 8, and 9, the slot values range anywhere between 250 and 150, 125. I put my number out there, which was over the slot value, so it would have been an overpay situation. So that would have counted against them. And some teams weren't willing to do that, and some teams couldn't do that. Those teams that they fell into those two categories, they were out. The few teams that were still in and wanted to try and make an offer, they all made offers, and it was under what I put on the table as my number. It was more around the slot values. I didn't feel like it was worth it. And so, again, here we stand.
Your father, Tim, played minor league ball. How big of a role did he play in this decision, and how much did he talk to you about it?
He was huge, man. He was good just to kind of have around, and I mean, he's been through it. I mean, back when he got drafted, it was a little bit different now. I mean, like he was telling me, he was like, I mean, we watched it all of Tuesday. We sat in the living room and watched the TV, I had my phone in my hand. But he said, he was like, when I got picked, man, I knew the date it was going to happen, but he was like, there was no radio, there was no TV to listen to it, there was no broadcast or anything, and so he was like, the Pirates drafted me at like noon, 12:30 that day, and I didn't find out until like 10 o'clock that night. He was like, so I went the whole day thinking that no one picked me. He was like, and I was pissed. He was like, I had it in my head that I was going back because I was mad, no one had picked me in the rounds that I thought, and somebody calls me and say, hey, yeah, we picked you in the fourth round. And so it was a little different back then when he did it, but I mean, just his insight as to what minor league ball would be, what minor league ball is like, what to expect as far as draft, and just to realize, man, it is a business, and you know, you start realizing that, you know, I got a crash course in that, you know, a few days ago. So
Gunnar Leger, our guest, ESPN1420.com. How big of a role does Coach Rowe play in that process, Gunnar?
Big, you know, he does a good job of he kind of wants to stay out of it. He believes it's a decision for me and my family. So I mean, he supports whatever we do. And he told me that, he expressed that to me. But you know, Coach Rowe's Coach Rowe, man, I'll never have anything to say about that man. So
who was the, once, you know, you made the decision, all right, I'm going to return to Louisiana for my senior season, you're there with your family. Who was the first person you told after that?
Well, after Tuesday, when I didn't get picked, or we just couldn't come to an agreement in the top 10 rounds, I called Coach Robe after that and just kind of kept him up to date on everything that had happened. And then we sat as a family that night after those rounds got announced. And we basically were kind of trying to decide if we wanted to even, you know, leave it up for debate the next day for rounds 11 through 40. And so I basically came to a decision that there was nothing that was going to happen on Wednesday that was going to make me not want to go back. And so that decision was kind of made early in the morning on Wednesday, like 1 or 2 in the morning. And so we all went to sleep, got some rest, and then woke up and started informing teams of my decision. So there was some more teams that contacted me and still tried to draft me anywhere between like the 15th, 14th, and the 20th round. And I mean, when they called, I just informed them that I was going back, and that was my final decision. And then, you know, the Marlins drafted me, which I honestly was eating with my girlfriend at a barbecue joint in Monroe, and walked outside and got a phone call from the area scout, and he called me and he said, "Congrats on getting drafted." And I'm sorry, but I never got picked. Like, I never got drafted. And he was like, "No," he's like, "We just took you." And I was like, well, I mean, I appreciate it, but, sure, you know, I'm going back to school. I mean, I expressed that to everybody, including you guys. And he was like, no, we know, you know, we know your decision. We wanted to pick you. And I think they're going to try and make an offer and just see what happens. But again, they know my decision, and I'm going to stick behind that decision.
Gunnar Leger, our guest, you in your statement you released on social media, Gunnar, you talked about the, you know, the offer's just not being worth another year in front of the 5,000 strong at MLT Moore Field at Russo Park. You thank Cajun Nation, as you call them, the greatest college baseball fans in the country. Can you put into words what playing at UL means to you?
It means everything to me. I mean, honestly, it's the first college baseball I ever watched back when my grandfather has had season tickets for 20 years, you know, even before I was born. And so I can remember going to the park and watching guys like Hunter Moody, Scott Hawkins, guys like those guys play and pitch. And when I was, you know, four, five, 6 years old. And so it means everything to me. My family's from there. You know, I get to wear Louisiana across my chest, which is a state that I probably represent. Again, I mean, it's everything. It's awesome. It's especially the way the fans get behind us and support us, and especially have supported me. And so I'm forever indebted to that university and Coach Rowe.
Gunnar Leger, have you talked to some of your teammates who were drafted? Have you talked to Steven or Evan or Wyatt?
Oh, yeah. Talked to all of them and congratulated them. So obviously Evan and Steven have signed, and I know Wyatt is, I think Wyatt still has some negotiating to do. But I mean, I just told him congratulations, and just kind of told Wyatt, I know Wyatt kind of still has a decision to make. Just kind of told him to go with his gut, man. I mean, my gut was telling me to come back, and, I listened to it. And so just told him that I loved him and that he deserved it. And, that to stick with what his heart told him to do.
How important is playing pro ball to you? I mean, obviously, it's not in the immediate future. As and a couple days ago, that was kind of up in the air, but it's still in your future, Gunner. How important is it to you?
Very important. I think that's why Tuesday was tough, man. It was tough for me and tough for my family. You know, I like to think that I've worked pretty hard at this and it was, you know, I've been able, blessed enough to excel at every level that I've played at. And so, I mean, again, nothing changes, you know, just keep working, whether it be in minor league ball, you know, I'd be in rookie ball or wherever I'd be if I would have signed. But again, you just keep developing. Might not be with whoever, you know, a big league team, but I'm going to continue to develop. I'll just have a Raging Cajun jersey on.
What do you want to work on most in the offseason?
Just continue to develop as far as, you know, strength goes. Might tinker with developing a new pitch that I've messed with for a while. And kind of just get back to finishing games, man. I feel like there was a few times this year where we were able to get some pretty big leads on Friday, which doesn't happen, you know, doesn't happen a lot, especially facing the best arms from the other team. And so I feel like there was a few times this year where we got those, you know, 5, 6, 7 run leads, and I lost a little bit of focus in that moment and went out and, you know, ended up walking a guy or walking a few guys, giving up a few hits and giving up a few runs and extended the inning, extended my pitch count. And, you know, when we're swinging it like that, especially on a Friday against their guy, you know, the last thing you want to do is keep them away from the plate. So it's my job to get them in and let them keep scoring runs.
Gunner, in your first two seasons, you got to play in a super regional and then a regional. You guys are right there kind of on the bubble this year. It didn't happen. Could you describe just the disappointment within the team and with yourself with just how the season unfolded? Because I know you guys felt like you had a lot of unfinished business left out on the diamond.
Yeah, most definitely. You know, I really don't. I mean, it's definitely disappointing. You know, I don't. You know, it's hard for me to look at one thing and say, you know, that was the reason, or, you know, maybe we could have done this a little better and things would have changed. But I mean, if you look at it, man, very successful programs have down years. And so the UL baseball program is obviously very successful in the past 5 years. The track record is, you know, stands up with the best teams in the country. And so, you know, we had a bad year. I mean, it is what it is. It happens. I mean, nobody was happy about it. Including me, including the fans, and definitely including Coach Robe and the coaching staff. So we're going to make some changes that we think need to be made as far as, you know, internally and some different stuff, leadership wise, and we'll be better. So,
what's the goals for next season, Gunner?
I mean, every year is our goal is 40, 45 plus wins. You know, win the regular season and conference championship, a regular season conference champion, the tournament championship, and then, you know, host a regional and get to Omaha. So, I mean, like I said last year, I mean, we were a very talented team last year. You know, but I mean, it's not all talent. You know, you got to have some things go your way. You got to, I mean, it takes a lot to be able to make a run like we have had, you know, the past, especially since I've been here in the year before when they hosted and were a national seed. So again, we're working in the right direction, and we're hungry, and you know, we're gonna get it back going.
Gunner Leggia has been our guest. I know it's been a busy couple of days for you, Gunner. We appreciate you making the time. A couple of fun questions before we let you go. Who's your favorite MLB team and who's your favorite player?
Favorite MLB team? Well, I've been a Yankees fan just about my whole life. I know that probably sounds cliche, everybody's a Yankees fan. But no, my babysitter when I was younger was actually Danielle Guidry, Ryan Guidry's daughter.
Wow.
And so I kind of got suckered in, got some signed baseballs and some T-shirts and some stuff from Mr. Ron. And so I got suckered into that when I was younger. Favorite player? I don't know. Right now, I'd have to say Dallas Keuchel, man. I think me and him have a lot of similarities. And I just like watching him go to work, watching him pitch, change speeds, and you know, baffle hitters.
Who's your favorite football team?
Favorite football team? Oof. Professional?
Yeah, NFL.
NFL. Jeez. I'd have to say the Saints. I know they haven't been good. I don't watch very much professional football. I'll watch guys play, you know, individual players. I'd rather, you know, I like watching Odell Beckham play and play explosive guys like that. But you know, I got to pull for the hometown team or the home. You know,
that's right. That was the right answer. But to your point, you're a fan more of players than teams. Bottom line.
Yeah.
All right. What's the best baseball movie?
The best baseball movie. Oof. You mean you can't go wrong with The Sandlot? I've watched that since I was young. Watched it probably too many times. Sandlot. Bull Durham is a classic. Major League. I'd probably have to say Bull Durham. Bull Durham's is pretty good.
Gunnar Leger has been our guest. Gunnar, I'll let you close it out. What's your message to Cajun Nation before we let you run?
That we're gonna be back, man. And you know, I want everybody there. And, you know, I know a lot of people were disappointed in what happened last year. But you know, my wish is that every game, no matter if it's a Friday night or a Tuesday night, that place is packed and there's not a seat open. And so that only helps us as the year goes on. So, you know, if you all believe, we always believe, and it's a lot stronger push when there's, you know, 6,000 people and there's 30 of us pushing in the same direction. So,
All-American Gunnar Leger, all the best with your decision, Gunnar. I know Cajun fans are looking forward to seeing you out on the diamond next year on the mound. I'm looking forward to covering you for another season in a Cajun uniform. Appreciate you taking the time.
Yes, sir. Thank you for having me.
You got it.